Okay, dear students, so today we'll be starting with the topic of uptake of water in plants. So water movement up a plant or uptake of water in plants. So you already know that water is going to be absorbed by root hairs, and this water has to travel against the gravitational force to reach each and every part of the plant. So they have to reach the leaf, they have to reach the tip of the stem. So buds, every part of the plant, so the water has to reach, and that is against the gravitational force. From the roots, the water is absorbed. The water and minerals are absorbed through the roots, and they have to travel against the gravitational force. So for this to travel against the gravitational force, it needs energy. So in your house itself, when you are having the sump and overhead tank. So if you have to pump the water from the sump to the overhead tank, so you require a motor. You use a motor, you switch on the motor. So you spend this energy to pump the water from lower region to the higher region, from sump to the overhead tank. So there the expenditure of energy is there. Even in plants, so they require energy to supply the water from the lower part of the plants, that is from the roots to the tip of the stem. Okay, some of them are 110 meter tall trees also. So how do they supply this water? So there are various forces that are responsible for movement of water within the plant. So let us study a few of them. So root pressure is assumed to be one of those forces. The ions from the soil, they are actively transported into the vascular tissues of the root, that is the xylem. So water follows its potential gradient and increases the pressure inside the xylem. Okay, so the water is going to enter through its potential gradient, that is from a higher water potential to low. We have already discussed the water follows its potential gradient and it increases the pressure inside the xylem. Within the xylem, they are going to increase the pressure. So there is a positive pressure created and we call this as root pressure. So this root pressure helps to push up water to small heights in the stem. It is not up to 110 meter tall. Up to small heights, root pressure pushes up the water in the stem. So that is because of the positive pressure that is created within the xylem, the xylem of the roots, that water is pushed up to small heights in the stem. And this is because of root pressure. So how do we prove this various movements, water movement up a plant? So an experiment is done to prove existence of root pressure. Okay, see here you have slides which shows this guttation, loss of water in the form of water droplets through the water stomata. So this is guttation part of it where you can see the water droplets being accumulated even in the grass. Loss of water in the form of water droplets, we call it as guttation. So this is the guttation process. So during early morning, having the atmospheric moisture, so if you cut a soft plant stem horizontally near the base, so the drop of solution oozes out of the cut stem. So from the cut stem, the water is oozing out. Why is that oozing out? This is due to the positive root pressure. So early in the morning, which is having when there is plenty of atmospheric moisture. So cut a soft plant stem, that is herbaceous stem at the base. So if you you notice that small drops of solution ooze out of the cut stem. So from the cut stem, small drops of water or solution is going to ooze out. And this solution is oozing out, or oozing means it is coming out. Okay, so this small amount of solution that is squeezed out of the cut stem, this is due to the positive root pressure. So the small amount of solution which is coming out of the cut part of the stem, that is due to the positive root pressure. This itself is an example for positive root pressure. At night and early morning, evaporation is low. That is why you can notice this when the early morning you have to cut this. So at night and early morning, the evaporation of water is very low. So excess water collects as droplets around small special openings of veins near the tip of grass blades and leaves of many herbaceous plant. So such water loss in liquid phase is called as guttation. So you should remember early in the morning when you are walking barefoot on a grass or a lawn, you feel it to be very wet. And that is not because of the mist or morning dew. Many of us believe that the mist might have settled as morning dew on the leaflets of grass. That is not the case at all. So rather the plants, like grass plants and a few of the herbaceous plants, the early in the morning and late in the evening, when the evaporation rate is less, they are going to lose water in the form of water droplets through the water stomata. We call it as hydatode. So the dew factor, whenever they are playing a cricket match, day and night match. So many of them, they speak at the second session, there would be dew factor plays an important role. Rather than dew factor, you should call it as guttation factor. Okay, the grasses will be oozing out water during the early in the morning and late in the evening when the evaporation rate is less. And this water oozing out through this special opening or this water stomata, we call it as guttation. And that is possible because of root pressure also. At night and early morning, evaporation is low. So excess water collects as droplets around special openings, which we call it as hydatodes or water stomata. So water collects here as droplets around special openings of veins. So such beautiful arrangement of water droplets, it almost looks like morning dew. So what we call it as morning dew is not a dew at all. Rather, it is from the plant, they are losing the water droplets around special opening of veins near the tip of grass blades in the sense leaf blade, and leaves of many herbaceous plants. So you can notice this water droplets around special opening. So such water loss in liquid form is called as guttation. See, guttation is the process of loss of water in the form of water droplets through the water stomata or hydatode. We call it as guttation. See, transpiration is loss of water in the form of water vapor through the stomata. Okay, it is water vapor through the stomata. Here it is water droplet through the water stomata or hydatode. So that is the difference between guttation and transpiration. Transpiration takes place throughout the daytime. Okay, so whereas guttation takes place early in the morning and late in the evening when the moisture level in the atmosphere is less and there is no evaporation. So at that part of time, you notice the guttation taking place. So this is an experiment to prove existence of root pressure. See, the root pressure, uptake of water by root pressure, it can only provide a modest push in the water transport. It has no major role in water movement up the tall trees. So it can explain water movement in herbs, but not in tall trees. So the greatest role of root pressure is to re-establish the continuous chain of water molecules in the xylem. So one of the biggest help that the root pressure provides is to re-establish the continuous chain of water molecules in the xylem. So which often breaks under the tension created by transpiration. So the continuous water chain is maintained by this root pressure, which is often broken by the tension that is created by the transpiration. So one of the best role of root pressure is to re-establish the continuous chain of water molecules in this xylem, which would often break under the pressure or tension created by the transpiration. In most of the plants, majority of water transport, it occurs by transpiration pull. In majority of plants, the water transport against the gravitational force, it is occurring by transpirational pull. So let us understand this transpirational pull concept. So the long distance transport of water, especially the uptake of water or water movement up a plant, it is because of this transpirational pull. So in plants, the water flows upwards through the xylem, achieves fairly high rates, up to 15 meter per hour. So the plants can, the upward flow of water through the xylem, it can reach up to 15 meter per hour. 15 meter is quite a distance per hour. So water is mainly pulled through the plant, and that the driving force for this process is transpiration. So this theory, which explains the movement of water against the gravitational force due to transpiration, we call it as the cohesion tension transpirational pull. So this we call it as cohesion tension transpirational pull model of water transport. So the cohesion tension transpirational pull theory was put forth to explain this uptake of water. So that is what we have to remember about. So transpiration pull is a major force through which the uptake of water takes place in trees. Okay, in plants, the water flow upward through the xylem, and it achieves a fairly high rate, that is about 15 meter per hour it travels. So water is mainly pulled through the plant, and the driving force for this process is transpiration. So we also call it as cohesion tension transpirational pull model of water transport. I've already told you that as per this model, so you have to remember this two concepts, cohesive force and transpirational pull. See, transpirational pull, that is transpiration is loss of water in the form of water vapor through the stomata. So they are taking place. As a result of that, nearly 95% of water that is absorbed by plants, it is lost through this water stomata. So it not water stomata, through the stomata they lose 95% of water that is absorbed. So when they lose so much amount of water, there is a suction pressure, a negative pressure is created. There is a suction pressure created which pulls the water along the xylem. And why does the water molecule move along? Because of this cohesive force, the force of attraction between like molecules. As a result of that, they move against the gravitational force because of this cohesive nature of water molecules. Okay. So this transpiration we'll be discussing about. So you know that when you take a lower epidermal peel, you have this stomata in the lower epidermis. So you will be looking in a dicot leaf. In the lower epidermis, you have the stomata. Whereas in case of a monocot leaf, both in the upper epidermis and lower epidermis, we can notice this stomata. So transpiration is the loss of water in the form of water vapor through the stomata. So we call it as transpiration. Nearly 95% of all the water that is absorbed by the plant is lost through transpiration. That is why one of the American physiologists, he has said that transpiration is a necessary evil. Transpiration is necessary as well as it is evil, something which is unavoidable. So transpiration is a necessary evil. So because transpiration takes place, there is uptake of water. And this transpiration itself is also responsible for 95% loss of water that is being taken up by this plant. So that is the reason the American physiologist, he has said that transpiration is a necessary evil. Okay, so here you can see the lower epidermis with the stomata. Stoma is the opening. Surrounding them, they have the guard cells. So we already have discussed about the stomatal apparatus. Okay. So these are all various experiments. Here they are, the slides are there to show that how stomata is. We are losing water, the plants are losing water through the stomata. So transpiration is the evaporative loss of water by plants through the stomata in the leaves. So the evaporative loss of water by plants through the stomata in the leaves. So less than 1% of the water reaching the leaves is used in photosynthesis and plant growth. The remaining is lost by transpiration. So there is less than 1% of the water which reaches the leaves. It is used in photosynthesis. The water that is reaching the leaves is used in photosynthesis and the growth of the plant. The remaining water is lost by transpiration. So the transpiration, we can study it by this cobalt chloride paper. So it turns color, the blue to pink on absorbing water. So during transpiration, exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the leaf also occurs. Okay, so there is exchange of respiratory gases also taking place through the leaf. So transpiration is the evaporative loss of water by plants through the stomata in the leaves. So there is less than 1% of the water which reaches the leaves, which is used in photosynthesis. And plant growth. The remaining water is lost by transpiration. So the transparent color, that is from blue to pink on absorbing water. So you can, that itself is an indication that leaves are undergoing transpiration. So cobalt chloride paper, which is blue in color, it is going to turn into pink on absorbing water. So this experiment proves that transpiration is taking place through the leaf. And it is very important to note that only 1% of the water reaching the leaves is used in photosynthesis and plant growth. The remaining water is lost by transpiration. So that is the reason I told you that transpiration is a necessary evil. So during transpiration, simultaneously, there is also exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the leaf through the stomata is also taking place. During transpiration, there is exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the leaf also it takes place. So you should also understand stoma are open in daytime, the stomata are open in daytime and closed during nighttime. So if you look into the structure of a stomata, they have this kidney-shaped guard cells. In case of dicot stomata, they have kidney-shaped guard cells. In case of monocot stomata, they would be dumbbell-shaped. We have already discussed in the plant anatomy part of it. So the stoma or stomatal aperture, you can notice, and they are guarded by this guard cells, the kidney-shaped cells. Surrounding this kidney-shaped cells, you can notice this subsidiary cells and epidermal cells. So the stomata are open during daytime and closed during nighttime. So the opening or closure of stomata due to change in the turgidity of the guard cells. So whenever, see, you can notice in the guard cells, the inner walls are thick. The inner walls which are lining this stoma or opening, they are thick and the outer walls are thin. Okay, so during daytime, the turgidity of the guard cells keep it open. The inner walls are kept open and during nighttime, they are closed. Okay, so the inner wall of guard cell lining stomatal aperture is thick and elastic and the outer wall, if you notice, is thin. So when turgidity of the guard cell increases, the outer walls bulge out and pull the inner walls into a crescent shape. So the outer walls bulge out and pulls the inner walls into a crescent shape. It is almost like a half moon shape. You can see that. So whenever the stoma is open. So the turgidity of the cell increases during the daytime, and the outer wall, they bulge out, and they are going to pull the inner walls into a crescent-shaped structure. So this is what you notice of the mechanism of opening and closing of stoma. It is also, you can call it as stomatal dynamics. The opening and closing of stoma, you can also call it as stomatal dynamics. There are various theories to explain this stomatal dynamics, but we don't have that for study, so I'm not going into that. So there is starch sugar hypothesis. Then there is potassium ion pump theory, which is the most accepted theory for the opening and closing of stomata. So the opening and closing of stoma, that is mainly brought about by this potassium ion pump theory. There is influx and efflux of potassium ions, and that is going to change the turgidity of the guard cells. So during nighttime, during daytime, the turgidity of the guard cells are high. As a result, the outer walls, they are going to bulge out and pull the inner walls, which opens in a crescent-shaped structure. During nighttime, the turgidity of the guard cells are lower. As a result of it, the inner walls come back, the outer walls come back to its normal shape, and the inner walls, they are going to close, and the stoma is closed during the nighttime. So the transpiration.
Can you please go to the previous slide, sir? One more previous.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. Done, sir. You have any doubts here?
No, sir.
See, now transpiration we'll further discuss about. So there are the microfibrils are there within the stomata, isn't it? So the cellulose microfibrils in the guard cells, they are oriented radially. So you can see that they are as if a radius of a circle, they are oriented. So the cellulose microfibrils in the guard cells, they are oriented radially rather than longitudinally. They are not lengthwise. They are radially, they are oriented, making it easier for the stoma to open. Okay, that is also one of the advantage of this microfibrils. They are oriented radially, making it easier for stoma to open, which would not have been the case if it was oriented longitudinally. Okay, so the guard cells, they lose turgidity due to water loss. So when can a cell become turgid? So when the water enters inside, when they lose the water, so they lose their turgidity and the inner walls regain their original shape. As a result, the stoma closes. So during nighttime, the guard cell loses their turgidity. They lose their turgidity due to loss of water from the guard cells. And the inner walls are going to retain their original shape. As a result, the stoma closes. Usually, the lower surface of a dicot leaf has a greater number of stomata. In monocot leaf, both the upper and lower epidermis of the leaf, equal number of stomata are found on both the surfaces. Whereas in dicot leaf, the lower surface of the leaf has stomata. Now, what are the factors which affect transpiration? So the factors affecting transpiration are external factors and plant factors or internal factors. So the external factors are temperature, light, humidity, wind. So the external factors which affects the transpiration are temperature, light, humidity, and wind. The plant factors, that is internal factors, number and distribution of stomata, number of stomata open, water status of the plant, canopy structure of the plant, that is the outline of the plant. So some of the canopy structures are inverted cone-like. In coniferous trees, you find that they have a cone-like structure. In some of the plants, the canopy is broad and spread. So the outline of the tree, we call it as the canopy. And the canopy structure also plays a role in the transpiration. So now the external factors, they have not discussed about it. So the temperature, So for every 10 degree rise in the temperature, the rate of reaction doubles up. So all those we have studied about. So temperature and light, they are interconnected. So when light is more, then photosynthesis takes place and there is a requirement of water. And as a result of that, the stoma has to be open during the daytime. And whenever photosynthesis it takes place, so that is also going to increase the osmotic potential of guard cells, which makes it to become turgid. So the guard cells become turgid due to the photosynthesis and the products obtained from it. Humidity. So how does this affect the transpiration? So whenever the atmospheric water vapor that is present, we call it as humidity. Whenever humidity is high in the atmosphere, transpiration is low. Whenever the humidity is low in the atmosphere, transpiration is high. So wind is going to benefit the transpiration because they carry away this water vapor layer that are found above the leaf. Okay, so the internal factors like the rate of transpiration is going to be affected by the number of and distribution of stomata. If the stomata are more in number and they are distributed in both the upper and lower surface, then they have a better rate of transpiration. So, and not only that, the number of stomata which is open is also important. If more number of stomata are open, then it leads to transpiration. So the water status of the plant is also important. If the plants are having lesser water, they lose less water in the due to transpiration. So the water status of the plant, availability of water in the soil and the water absorbed by the plants also determines the rate of transpiration. The canopy structure, if it is a wider canopy, so they have more possibility of losing water through this wider canopy than a canopy of coniferous nature. So the canopy structure also determines the rate of transpiration. So these are the factors which affects transpiration. So the external factors are temperature. So the temperature are going to affect the rate of transpiration. So whenever there are higher temperatures, the evaporation rate are more. So that also is going to increase the rate of transpiration. Whenever the temperatures are lower, so that also the rate of transpiration is lower because the evaporation rate is also lower. So light also plays an important role in making the guard cells osmotically active. So photosynthesis, so they require more amount of water to be absorbed. As a result of that, light also plays an important role. So the humidity, availability of water vapor in the atmosphere. So relative humidity in the atmosphere, if it is more, then transpiration is less. If humidity in the atmosphere is higher, the transpiration is low. So I would always explain this humidity taking two cities into consideration. One city is Chennai, another city is Delhi. Both the places, the temperatures are very high. Okay, but in Chennai, the humidity is high. And in Delhi, the humidity is low. Why there is humidity is high in Chennai is because it is at the coastal area. So the water vapor in the atmosphere would be higher, as well as temperatures are higher. Whereas in Delhi, the water vapor in the temperatures are higher, but humidity is low. So when we are as human beings, when we sweat in Delhi, so it immediately gets evaporated and it creates a cooling effect on us. But in Chennai, what happens is, so when we are sweating because of the higher temperatures, but it doesn't get evaporated because of humidity in the atmosphere. As a result of that, we feel very sticky with sweat, and we also feel that, what do you call it, as unclean aspect of it. So, and there is no cooling of the body because of higher humidity in the atmosphere. So keeping this in mind, you can understand that even though temperatures are higher both in Delhi and Chennai, humidity plays an important factor. So many times you might have found that many of the cricket players, they find it difficult to play in Chennai, whereas they find it easier to play in Delhi because humidity is low in Delhi as as a result of that, even when they sweat, so that is going to be evaporated and it creates a cooling effect. But in Chennai, that sweat is not evaporated. As a result of it, you feel sticky and dirty in Chennai after sweating, because the humidity in the atmosphere is high. So remember about that. Even in the trees, if a tree in Delhi will be having higher temperature and lower humidity, so since the humidity is lower, there the rate of transpiration is higher than when compared to Chennai, where temperature is also higher, humidity is also high, transpiration will be low, because already the atmosphere is saturated with water vapor. So then I spoke about wind. So wind is going to remove this layer of the water vapor that is around the leaves. So the wind is movement of air. That is what is wind. So the wind is going to remove this layer of water vapor that is accumulated along the leaves, and that favors more transpiration. Okay. Now we'll go for this transpirational pull theory. And already in the previous class, I had told you about to remember the example of the borewell, where the water is sucked from the underground, water is sucked above the ground. So whenever we are pumping a borewell, so we are removing this air from it and we are creating a negative pressure. So that suction pressure is created. As a reason, the water from underground, they are going to rise above this, the water pipe, the borewell pipe, and they are going to come out. And this water would be a continuous flow. Okay, why are the water going to come as a continuous flow is because of this cohesive force, the force of attraction between similar molecules like water and water, it is higher. And also the suction pressure that has been created, it drags along the water, and that is the reason the water comes out continuously through the borewell whenever we are pumping the borewell. So it is almost similar to the transpirational pull theory. See, water has that unique nature where their cohesion, mutual attraction between water molecules are high, which results in a continuous column of water chain being formed. So they are dragged together. This continuous water column chain is formed because of cohesive force. And there is also an attraction of water molecule to the polar surfaces, like the surface of tracheary elements in this example. In borewell, it is the borewell pipe. There's an attraction of water molecule to the polar surfaces of the borewell pipe in borewell. Okay, so surface tension in liquid phase, water molecules are more attracted to each other than in gaseous phase. So that is what we call it as surface tension. Okay, so let us discuss one by one. So the transpirational pull theory, so the transpiration driven ascent of xylem sap. Ascent of xylem sap is nothing but uptake of water. Okay, it depends on the following physical properties of water. So what are those? So the transpirational pull, you can explain through this. Cohesion force, cohesive force or cohesion. The mutual attraction between water molecules. Cohesion is a mutual attraction between similar molecules. Since we are discussing about water, it is the mutual attraction between water molecules is there. And adhesion, the attraction of water molecules to polar surfaces. That is here the surface of tracheary elements. So the adhesion. So adhesion, you can notice, it is the attraction of water molecules to the polar surfaces. Okay. So that is the attraction, force of attraction between dissimilar molecules, water and the walls of the tracheary elements. Okay. So this cohesion and adhesion force are responsible for the water to remain as a continuous column. A chain of water molecules are held together, and this continuous column is because of this cohesion and adhesion that water has. Then surface tension, you find that in liquid phase, water molecules are more attracted to each other than in the gaseous phase. That is the reason the water climbs the xylem vessels as a continuous column. Okay. So these properties, that is cohesion, adhesion and surface tension, these properties give water high tensile strength, the ability to resist a pulling force. See, now this water has to be pumped against the gravitational force. So now the strength of this tensile strength of this water should be greater than the gravitational pull. Okay, so these properties give this water high tensile strength. So that is the ability to resist a pulling force. Now the pulling force is gravitational force, and high capillarity, ability to rise in thin tubes. See, whenever capillary tube, you might have seen in the utilized in the chemistry lab, or you'll be utilizing in the future, they are very microscopic tubes. Okay, when you put it into a solution, without you sucking or putting any effort, some amount of solution rises in the capillary tube because of the atmospheric pressure. So there is also this capillarity, the ability to rise in thin tubes is also noticed in water. So the properties of water, like cohesion, adhesion, and surface tension, they give the water high tensile strength, which can withstand the opposite force pulling them down, that is gravitational force. And it also has high capillarity, that is the ability to rise in thin tubes. In plants, capillarity is aided by the small diameter of the tracheary elements. Okay, they are microscopic. The tracheary element diameter is microscopic. So the tracheids and vessel elements, so the capillarity is aided by the small diameter. Smaller the diameter, greater the climb of the liquid that you can notice. So in plants, capillarity is aided by the small diameter of the tracheary elements, that is the tracheids and vessels. So tracheids you find in pteridophytes and gymnosperms, vessels you find in angiosperms. So the next that you have to remember is the xylem vessels from the root to leaf vein, they supply water for photosynthesis. Okay, so there is a continuous thin film of water over the cells. So as water evaporates through the stomata, water pulls into leaf from the xylem. Okay, so in atmosphere, concentration of water vapor is lower than in the substomatal cavity and intercellular spaces. So this also helps water to diffuse into the surrounding air. This creates a pull. So the loss of water through transpiration by the leaf, it creates a pull. It creates a negative hydrostatic pressure, okay, or suction pressure, we call it as. The force generated by transpiration can create pressure sufficient to lift a xylem sized column of water over 130 meters high. So the force which is generated by this transpiration can create a pressure which is sufficient to lift a xylem sized column, that is micro sized. Diameter of xylem is very, very small. You know that xylem sized column of water, this transpiration pull is sufficient to pull the water up to 130 meters high. So the force generated by transpiration can create a pressure sufficient to lift a xylem sized column of water up to 130 meters high. That is the force that is created by the transpiration. Okay, so the photosynthesis is limited by availability of water, which is swiftly depleted by transpiration. You know that the raw materials for photosynthesis are carbon dioxide and water. Carbon dioxide is obtained from the atmosphere through the stomata. Water is obtained from the roots through this uptake of water. So photosynthesis is always limited by available water. And this available water is immediately lost through transpiration. Less than 1% of water is utilized by the plants as for photosynthesis that we have discussed already. So the humidity of rainforest is mainly due to the cycling of water from root to leaf to atmosphere and back to soil. So the humidity of rainforest, the tropical rainforest, is mainly due to cycling of water from root to leaf and leaf to atmosphere and from atmosphere back to the soil. So this cycling of water from root to leaf, leaf to atmosphere, and atmosphere to soil. So this is the cycling which is responsible for the humidity of the rainforest. Is mainly due to the cycling of water from root to leaf, and leaf to atmosphere, and atmosphere to soil. Okay. So the C4 photosynthetic system helps to maximize availability of carbon dioxide and minimize water loss. So a C4 plant is twice as efficient as C3 plant in fixing carbon. However, it loses only half as much water as a C3 plant for the same amount of carbon dioxide fixed. So C4 plant is photosynthetically better than a C3 plant. We'll be discussing about this photosynthesis, C4 pathway, C3 pathway. See, C3 pathway, you can see normal photosynthesis. C4 pathway is hatch and slack pathway. So we'll be discussing about that when we come to the topic of photosynthesis in plants. A C4 plant, which fixes carbon dioxide as C4. So that C4 plant is twice more efficient than C3 plant in fixing carbon. So that is making sugar. However, this C4 plant loses only half the amount of water as a C3 plant for the same amount of carbon dioxide fixed. So C4 plant has better capability of fixing carbon dioxide, and it loses lesser water. That is what you can see, notice in a C4 plant, which is photosynthetically much more efficient than a C3 plant. Okay. So what are the uses of transpiration? So the transpiration creates a pull for absorption and transport. So the water uptake is because of this transpiration. Even translocation of organic solutes to an extent is because of transpirational pull. So transpiration also supplies water for photosynthesis. So transpiration transports mineral from soil to all parts of the plant. So transpiration cools the leaf surfaces, just like we have perspiration or sweating to cool our body surface whenever we are in hot conditions. So similar to that, transpiration also cools the leaf surfaces. Sometimes the cooling effect is such that it cools the leaves by 10 to 15 degrees by evaporation. So that is how they maintain a very amicable temperatures around the leaf. So it maintains the shape and structure of the plants. So the transpiration maintains the shape and structure of the plants by keeping the cells touch it. So still transpiration does not take place. So the shape and structure of the plants will be affected because of lack of water. So the transpiration maintains the shape and structure of the plants by keeping the cells touching. So these are a few uses of the transpiration. So transpiration creates a pull for absorption and transport. It supplies water for photosynthesis, transports minerals from soil to all parts of the plant. It cools the leaf surfaces, sometimes 10 to 15 degrees centigrade by evaporation. It maintains the shape and structure of the plant by keeping the cells touched. So these are all the uses of transpiration. So the uptake and transport of mineral nutrients we'll be discussing in the next class. So as of now, so all these we'll be discussing in the next class. Let us concentrate only on the ascent of sap or uptake of water for today's class. So you have any doubts regarding the students?